You may be seated. Thanks, team. It is an honor and a privilege to be with you today. The process that we've been through over the past few months, you've got an amazing elder team, search team, and staff team, and look forward to the privilege of serving with them and doing this together. I'm grateful for the years of ministry that many staff members and volunteers have put into the church over the 10, 11, 12, 13 years. And we're going to stand on that foundation, but we're also excited about the future. Amen?
Amen.
Because God is not done with this church. It's His church. I was thinking about this series today, as you can see on the screens around the table. And I don't know what kind of interview process you guys have been through in life, in corporate America, the local church, wherever you work. But we spent a lot of time around tables. Dining room tables and kitchen tables and restaurant tables and tables in coffee shops. Did a lot of eating during this interview process, right? A few weeks ago when we came back after we had accepted the call to come to Commonway, we actually had reached out to some friends that we didn't know, attended church, Brian and Dee. We have had some history with from years ago. Don't hold that against them if you don't like me. Okay, it's all right. But they reached out. We went out to lunch and hung out together. And we had done life together years ago in the Indy area, about 15 years ago. Hang out at the same church, attended worship, served together, had some of the same similar friends. I'm sure ate at some tables. Don't remember. I'm getting older. But we went out to eat to a local pizza joint. And it was great just to sit around the table. And in the next couple of hours, we probably laughed more than, at least I had laughed in months. We had told stories, some of which were joyful, some of which were of heartache. We probably talked about life and politics and religion and all the things you're not supposed to talk about, right? We left that place today just having a conversation around the table. What's interesting is this is something that's common in our culture, common in our worlds. We sit down, we eat, we drink, we have conversations. And what we want to do is we want to celebrate for the next few weeks of what it means to be around the table. Because the key idea, and we'll put this up on the screen to start with today, is this, is that there is power in gathering around the table. Whether it's in an interview process, hanging out with friends from 15 years ago, as you go out to lunch today, as you hang out at a caffeinery this week, there is power in gathering and hanging out around the table. Why? Because when you share stories of joy and of sadness, it's powerful. When you have conversations and you just laugh at each other and with one another, it's powerful. When you get to a point in relationship where you can lower your walls a little bit with a group of people, it's powerful. When you can practice vulnerability and you don't have to pretend and you don't have to fake it until you make it, sitting around the table with a group of people that you know can be absolutely powerful. And so that's where we're going to go for the next few weeks. But we're not experts at this, and we didn't create this, and we didn't start this. In fact, if you look into the Gospels, where we're going to go over the next few weeks, Jesus was an expert at this. Jesus was a master of gathering around the table and pointing people to God. He would show up in their homes. He would show up at their tables. He would show up in their fishing boats. He would eat food. He would drink with them. He would have conversations. And Jesus gives us an example. And if Jesus did this, as followers of Jesus, shouldn't we do it as well? And if this was the lifestyle of Jesus, and we're followers of His, shouldn't this be part of our lifestyle as well? So today we're going to start in the book of Luke. If you got a Bible, again, this is something you're going to probably hear me hit hard. If you're a follower of Jesus, bring your Bible, whether it's digital or it's a paper one, bring it with you. I don't want you to take what I'm saying for, you know, that I know it all. I want you to dig in. I want you to read it. I want you to grow as well. And here is Luke chapter 5, verse 27. The first three words, would you read these three words with me? And I like enthusiasm, and you can talk back in church, and it's a good thing. Would you read these three words with me? After this, Jesus. What? After what? What are you talking about? You see, I feel like one of the most important things when you're studying Scripture is context. too many followers of Jesus and too many people online today take a verse or take an idea and blow it up and make it their pet scripture and take it out of context. Every scripture in God's word has verses before and verses after. That's context. Every verse, every piece of theology, everything you study in scripture has chapters before and chapters after. That is what? Context. And in order to go where we're going to go today and gathering around the table talking about this, we need to start with these three words: after this, Jesus. Before Luke chapter 5, Jesus does something pretty amazing. He heals a guy. The cliff notes are basically this. Four friends bring a friend of theirs that had been paralyzed from birth. They show up at a house. They can't get into the house. Jesus has packed the house out. They go up on the roof. They tear the roof apart. They lower their friend down to get face to face with Jesus. And Jesus does something that is amazing. He actually interacts with this guy. He heals this man. That's the cliff notes. You can read it on your own, but this is the context. And there's two reactions in the crowd that day. Number one, the reaction is from the religious leaders, and the religious leaders despise Jesus because he emphasized relationship instead of religion. And they get in Jesus' face, and they question Jesus, and they wonder, how can you forgive sins, and why would you heal a guy, especially on the Sabbath day, God forbid? And there's a second reaction. The crowd around this man and around Jesus are blown away. They're in a state of shock and awe as to what this man just did. Because this man gets up, he walks out, his life is transformed. He will never be the same. This is the context of those first three words. And then here's what happens in the rest of Luke chapter 5, verses 27. It says, after this, Jesus went out after the miracle, after this crowd is around, after taking some smack from the religious leaders. After this, Jesus went out and he saw a tax collector, right? By the name of Levi, also known as Matthew in the other gospels. And he was sitting at his tax booth. After this miracle, Jesus goes out and has a face-to-face conversation, interaction with a guy by the name of Levi. He's a tax collector. Let's just have a little bit of fun in church today. I like a little bit of engagement, all right? So here's what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you to give me one of two responses. I'm going to ask a bunch of series of questions and wait to the end. Don't get excited. Wait to the very end. I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, and I want you to give me one of two reactions. I want you to give me an enthusiastic yeah. Let me hear that. A yeah.
Yeah.
Or, because I'm leading you along here, I'll give me an enthusiastic ugh. Yeah. All right, so Matthew, Levi was a tax collector. So here's my questions. How many of you just feel just great joy and enthusiasm in your life when it comes to paying taxes? Don't respond. Don't respond yet. How many of you love and are enthusiastic? What is your normal reaction when you think of those three words, IRS? How many, or what is your reaction when you think of April 15th or April 17th, whatever it is nowadays? What are your feelings if you got to write a big fat check to Uncle Sam? What are your feelings about how Washington, D.C., no matter how you lean, what do you think about Washington, D.C. and how they handle your tax money, all right? On the count of three, if you are enthusiastic and excited, I want you to give me a yeah. If you're not, I want you to give me an okay? 1, 2, 3. Yeah, see, that's what I thought. Okay, that's what I thought. Take those feelings, take those emotions. This is what's in the text. When people saw Levi, that is what they thought of him. When people saw the Roman Empire, which was the oppressive government of that day, which was oppressing the Jewish people, that is exactly what they thought of the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire not only oppressed the Jewish people, but they received taxes from the Jewish people. And here's the kicker. They would hire Jewish men to take the taxes from the Jewish people to give to the Roman Empire. And that is how they felt. And Levi, as a Jewish man, would not only receive the taxes on behalf of the Roman Empire, he would put a little extra something in his pocket so he could actually, you know, pay for internet and go to the grocery store and drive his Mercedes and do those kinds of things. He was corrupt. The very feelings that you have about taxation in our culture, whichever way you lean, is exactly the sentiment in that day and age, times 10, times 100, times 1,000. And Jesus goes down and has a personal interaction with a guy from the IRS. Jesus went down and did this in verse 27 and verse 28 when he sees Levi. Jesus says to him, what are these two words? Oh, come on, more enthusiastically. What are these two words?
Follow me.
Jesus walks up and shatters this paradigm. Follow me. And Levi got up and he left what? Can you help me out again?
Everything.
And he followed Jesus. Two of the most powerful words in the gospel, in my humble opinion, is when Jesus would walk up to people and say, follow me. And Jesus didn't care about your ethnicity. Jesus didn't care about your social economic status. Jesus didn't care whether you lived in a three-bedroom or an apartment. Jesus didn't care if you were white-collar or blue-collar. Jesus constantly went up to people that were very different from him, that were marginalized, that were on the edges, and he said, follow me. And if you read the Gospels, people followed Jesus in droves. And not only this, but in this particular case, Levi is not only transformed by Jesus, but he never goes back to his past. He never goes back to anything. He left his job. He left his status. He left his corruption. He left his cushy job. Jesus so transformed, it was not only a spiritual experience, but it was an economic experience that took place in his life. I want to pause here, and I want to begin to lean into the series, which we're going to be in over the next few weeks, and I'll be teaching, Lisa will be teaching, a few other speakers will be teaching, because we want to have a team-based idea here. But I want to lean into what we're talking about today, and simply is this, as number one, as a follower of Jesus, and I'm making an assumption today, you know, a lot of us in this room are followers of Jesus, committed to Jesus, but if you came to church today just because you wanted to stare at the new guy, that's okay. If you came to church today because you wanted to go out to eat with grandma afterwards or whatever it is, or you lost a bet, or you're seeking, or you're wondering, I'm glad you're here. I hope you'll listen in. I hope you'll find this is a group of people that love Jesus. We're not perfect, but we're trying to figure out what it means to follow him every day. But I want to address generally today as I start with the series, Jesus Followers. Now, here's the first idea. As a Jesus follower, number one, I am called to walk in relational proximity to others. Write that down somewhere. I am called to walk in relational proximity to others. What does that mean? If I'm going to make a difference in this world, I've got to be in the space and in the lives of other people. I can't hold up in my house. I can't hold up in my business. I can't do my own thing and somehow God use me to make an impact in this world. I've got to practice relational proximity. We've got to show up. Jesus showed up. Jesus goes down to the water, hangs out with what was considered a lowlife, a person of lack of reputation, and Jesus practices relational proximity. He went to their homes. He sat at tables. He hung out over a fire. He sat in their boats. And he goes right to Levi and practices at his workplace relational proximity. Let me ask just a couple of questions. Do you want to point people to Jesus in your life? It starts with relational proximity. You showing up in their world. You want to have relationships in your life that will be with you, that will stand with you, that will cry with you, that will be frustrated with you, that will be joyful with you. Hey, there's the work that needs to be done, and it starts with you practicing relational proximity. You want people in your life that will open up to you and allow you to help them grow and take the next step. It's not easy peasy. It requires relational proximity. You, as a follower of Jesus, have to show up in their world. You don't expect them to come to you. You show up in their world. At your corporate job, on the field that you play ball with, and the kids that you coach, and the kids that you mentor, and the wherever that may be, wherever God leads you, that is where you practice relational proximity. I put this in your notes as well today. Relational intimacy is what we all want. We all ask about it. Relational intimacy is built on the foundation of relational proximity. In other words, you can't lead people to Jesus without relational proximity. You can't have fully devoted relationships without relational proximity. Everybody wants the relational intimacy, but very few of us actually want to do the work that's required of it. Relational proximity. Keith and I were in Florida just last week, and a couple of weeks ago, we were trying to locate some furniture, and she found some furniture on Marketplace, because we had given some stuff away, and some stuff got old, and We ended up driving to Fort Myers. There was this couple that buys furniture and they rehab it and repaint it and reshape it, and then they sell it out of storage lockers. Sounds shady, but it's an actual legit business. We showed up and they have all this beautiful furniture, all the work that they've done, and Keese's having a conversation. It's a husband and wife team, and I noticed the husband was there, and I noticed that he appeared to be in pain, and I looked at him, and I don't know him from Jack, right? And I said, "You doing all right?" And he goes, "Yeah, I'm just in a lot of pain right now." So I'm like, "Do you mind me asking what's going on?" He goes, "Well, to be honest, I just had back surgery about a week ago, and I'm still in a lot of pain." I said, "Well, what in the world are you doing here?" That's why this is our business, and I wanted to represent it well, and I wanted to support my wife. I said, "So what are you doing about the pain?" So, I mean, I've had friends that have had hip replacements and knee replacements and back surgeries, and you look like you're in pain. What are you taking for pain? Are you taking some of that really strong stuff? And I kind of joked about it. And he goes, "Unfortunately, no." I said, so what do you mean? He said, "Well, I've got this track record in my life, and several years ago, I got addicted to opioids. And it was a dark time in my life. It was a difficult time in my life. It was a 5, 6, 7 years of my life, and it took me years to break this addiction." And again, this is two strangers. I said, "Tell me a little bit more about that." He says, "Yeah, I blew up a lot of things in my life, and I made the pledge with God's help," I don't know where this guy is spiritually, "to not go back to that dark place." It's interesting the things that people will share with you if you show up in their worlds. Yeah, I'd like to say that as a pastor and as a follower of Jesus, that right there in that storage room or that storage shelter, we prayed a prayer. That didn't happen. I'd like to share with you that something supernatural happened, like, you know, I'm interacting with this guy and he's talking about his addiction, and we're going back and forth, and the heavens open up and there's a voice that booms from heaven. That didn't happen. But don't miss the point. And this is kind of what I've been thinking about over the past few weeks as God allowed that story to take place in my life. Don't miss the simplicity of this. Maybe God allowed Keese and I to show up in their business to allow this guy to tell his story. And maybe I would like to think on some level that he told his story just because I showed up, because I showed value, because I asked questions, because I wondered about his life. Does that make sense? Because I was in his world practicing relational proximity. And this is what Jesus did over and over again. You know why Jesus did it? Jesus did it to build a religion, right? No. Jesus showed up with relational proximity in the lives of other people, wherever they were at tax booths, because he wanted to show them relationship. You can have hope in God. You can have peace in God. You can have purpose in God. You can have fulfillment in God. It ain't religion. It ain't about what you do. It's about pursuit of Jesus, and that's how we know God. And this is why Jesus constantly showed up in the lives of people. Say relational proximity. All right. It continues on in verse 29. Then Levi had a great banquet for Jesus at his house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others. And the word "others" is people that people would not normally hang out with. Levi's social circle. He was a tax collector, which means he didn't hang out with the uppity-uppities. He didn't hang out with the nicety-nice. He didn't hang out with the religious people. And a large crowd of tax collectors and others were at the party eating with them. It's amazing to me that Levi follows Jesus. His life is transformed by Jesus. And the first thing that he does is he throws a party for Jesus and his friends. I would like to think that in the context of this series, as we're going to look over the next few weeks, about getting around the table, the power of spending time around the table, that maybe somewhere in Levi's mind and heart, he thought, "You know what? Jesus transformed my life. It's time to get around the table." I would like to think that in some way he was thinking that on a deep level, I need to connect Jesus with my friends. And so he throws a party. "Hey, Jesus, here's my friends. Hey, friends, here's Jesus, the man that's radically transformed my life. I'm going to put you guys all together. We're going to sit at a table. We're going to eat. We're going to drink. Go at it." Because Levi wanted for his friends what he had already experienced for himself. And Levi teaches us something in the Gospels about gathering around a table, number 2. This comes right from Levi's life. As a follower of Jesus, I am called to walk in relational intimacy. Say those two words, relational intimacy with others. Yes, God is going to ask us and challenge us on our campuses, in corporate America, in the moms groups, in our neighborhoods, to spend relational proximity, to be in the lives of other people for seasons. But God is also going to challenge us to do a little bit more work and to bridge that gap and to take a relational risk and practice relational intimacy. Again, Jesus did it. You are going to learn, I'm going to learn through the series about what it means to invite people also into our world, to sit at our tables, to sit on our front porches, to sit in our backyards, to sit in our favorite spot at our favorite coffee shop, so we can invest in them. I said this earlier, but let me say it again. What happens around the table? Lots of eating and drinking. That's a good thing. In moderation. The table is a place for laughing and telling stories. The table is a place of discussion, disagreement, and mutual respect. And we've lost that in our culture. Let me say that again. We've lost that in our culture, that you can care about people and love people and sit at a dining room table and disagree with one another and still respect each other. The table is a place of vulnerability. It's a place where walls come down. The table is a place where we challenge each other and value each other. The table is a place where we share our pains and our joys. And Jesus constantly not only showed up in their lives, but made room at his table for them. And my challenge to you as the followers of Jesus, as Commonway Church, and as we go through the series, as we grow, not only do we show up in the lives of others, but we've got to make space for other people, especially the people that may not even be the same ethnicity as you, the same color of skin as you, the same social economic background as you, the same educational level as you. That is what Jesus followers do. Amen? I won't ask for amens a lot. It's just different for me, all right? But that's what we do. That's what we do. That's what we're called to be. And the people around you, some, are not going to like that. They didn't like it when Jesus did it. The Pharisees hated Jesus for showing up in the lives of other people and building bridges with people. Don't believe me? Verse 30. Here's what they said. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who belonged to their sect complained to the disciples. So why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? It's ironic that as I read this passage, that there's not much that changes in human nature at all in relationships. They're talking about Jesus, but they're not going to Jesus. Does that remind you of how we oftentimes live? They're complaining about Jesus, but they don't go directly to Jesus. They're circumnavigating the conversation, and they're having the conversation with the disciples. Hey, disciple guys, why in the world does Jesus hang out with these kinds of people? I mean, they're not like us. And they don't seem to be like him. We rag on the religious leaders of the day in the Gospels for good reasons, and Jesus did for good reasons. But the religious leaders started out, their purpose was to point people to God. I mean, if we're going to be simple about that, whether it was through the temple or the reading of the scriptures, their goal, their role was to be a mediator between themselves and God. Their goal was to point all people to God. And somewhere along the line, they got self-righteous. Somewhere along the line, they got, self-inflated. Somewhere along the line, they were too righteous and too good and too hoity-toity. Somewhere along the line, they will not spend time with other people, the very people that they were called to connect to God. I can't sit with them. I can't eat with them. I can't hang out with them. They can't shake my hand. They're unclean. And hey, and I'm pretty clean. Look at me. Jesus hears the response. He's in the background. Jumps into the conversation. Again, Jesus, God in the flesh, 100% divine, 100% human, both. Verse 31, Jesus says this, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. Newsflash, we're all sick. Welcome to Commonway Church, we're all sick. Might sound judgy, might sound in your face, Scriptures and Jesus say that we all suffer from the same sickness. It's called sin. We don't like to say that. There are things that we do in the dark and behind closed doors that we would be ashamed of. There's things that we have blown up in our past that we regret. There is a sickness that runs through the fiber of every person in this place. If you still got air in your lungs and you're still vertical, we all suffer from this sickness. This is all Jesus was trying to say. Jesus was trying to level the playing field. There's not a single person that's righteous. There's not a single person that's completely healthy. There's not a single person that's got this all figured out. We are all sick. This is what Jesus said, I came for. This is why he established the church. This is why we are called to make a difference in this world, to care for the sick. Verse 32, and I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. You see, I'm one of those guys that think repentance gets a bad rap because oftentimes it's been used inappropriately. There's some preacher on TV, he's got his finger and he's shaking it at somebody and he's calling them and telling them they're going to hell. And again, there's a lot of things that Jesus talked about, eternity and hell and sin, but this is not what repentance is. The true definition of repentance means I'm going in this way, I'm radically transformed, and I'm going in this direction. Jesus came into this world and put on flesh so we would stop running in our own rebellion and follow God. That's repentance. So instead of living a hopeless life, we have a life filled with hope. Instead of living a broken life, we live a life full of wholeness. Instead of living a life that is just totally trash, we have a life that is filled with fulfillment. That is repentance. Does that make sense? Barry Jones says it this way. He says, the table is the place where broken sinners find connection and belonging. Isn't that good news? That's good news for you. That's good news for me. That's good news for your college roommate. That's good news for your kids. That's essentially the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The table is the place where broken sinners find connection and belonging. I'm going to take the rest of this time and kind of lean into some application. You're going to find out, love it or hate it, over the next few months and years that I really feel that as followers of Jesus, that it's good to come together and celebrate and to learn God's word and to read quotes and to dig into God's word. And I try to keep it simple because I think sometimes we just throw too much. But I'm a person of application, because if you hear nice words and that pastor did good today or I didn't like his message, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, what God wants from us is obedience and application. And what I want most for you is to become more like Jesus. Some application. Cliff, I'm going to ask you to come forward here in the next few moments as we maybe do something acoustically and try to create an environment here of just reflection, because I would like to close in prayer. But as a means of application, here's what I'm going to ask you. There's three people in this story, and I'm going to ask you, which are you the most like right now in your life? Not who you hope to be, but which are you most identified with right now? There is the sinner, there is Levi, and there is Jesus. There is the sinner, there is Levi, and there is Jesus. And maybe today in this story, you most identify with in this season of life, you would say, maybe I am most like the sinner. And again, that's not a smackdown. That's not getting in your face. That is what Jesus called us, because that's who we are. That is what he came to redeem and to save. And even though that we are all sinners today, let me be very, very specific. I'm talking about people that are not in a relationship with God. I'm not talking about your knowledge of God. I'm not talking about you going to church. But maybe you're sitting here today and you're not in an active relationship with God through Christ. Christ would call us sinners. It's not mean. It's just reality. And if you were to be honest with people in this place today or your Heavenly Father, yeah, I'm sick. I'm broken. I have blown up relationships. I've blown up a couple of marriages. I've blown up a few jobs. I've blown up my family. I've blown up my integrity. Maybe that's you. Maybe you have gone through a season or you're in a season where you've been running from God, trying to find fulfillment in everything else, whether it's pornography or sexuality or success or relationships, and you've been running from God. I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to do it on my own. And maybe You've not just been running, but maybe you've had your fist in the face of God because of the pain or the tragedy or the difficulty of life that you've experienced. In spite of what you've done, in spite of who you are, here's the good news. Jesus loves you. And that's not just a bumper sticker you throw on your car. Jesus loves you so much that he went to the cross to die for your sins so that you would not stay dead in sins, but that you could be alive. Jesus was put into a grave and came out of the grave, not so we could celebrate a nice, happy holiday, but so that we could live life to the full, that we have life in this life and life in eternity one day. That is the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. And Christ loves you. So here's my application question for you today. If you would say, I'm a sinner, are you willing to sit at the table of Jesus? Imagine a table with Jesus sitting at it. He's got a chair right there for you with a big banquet. He just wants to spend time with you. He just wants to have a relationship with you. And here's some more good news. There's nothing you can do to earn that spot. You don't have to clean up your life. You don't have to fix your past. You don't have to memorize 13 books of the Bible. You don't have to be on stage like this guy. You don't have to pray so many hours a day. Here, the gift of Jesus, the gift of salvation is a free gift. To sit at the table of Jesus has already been paid for by the blood of Jesus. And he just said, would you come? You're invited. If that applies to you today, here's what I encourage you to do. Before you leave this place, tell somebody you know. You know what that Steve guy said today about following Jesus? I want to do that. Would you help me? If you feel led to do that today and you know somebody at Commonway Church, I encourage you to lean into that relationship because that's what we're called to be as followers and say, would you pray with me? Can we go out to lunch today? Can we have a conversation today? Because I feel like I'm at that place where I need to follow Jesus. And if you don't know anybody, that's okay. We got you covered. We got prayer tables, the front of our auditorium at the end of service. If you want to discreetly come up, we've got volunteers. They'll talk with you. They'll pray with you. They'll lead you closer to Jesus. I would encourage you to do that today. Number two, maybe you're like Levi. Maybe you're new in your faith days ago, weeks ago, months ago, and this is still all kind of new. This church thing is all kind of new. Following Jesus is all kind of new. It's great. My challenge for you simply is this. Are you willing to bring your friends to the table of Jesus? Think about it. Levi, as soon as he followed Jesus, what did he do? He threw a party. And he invited all of his friends to meet Jesus. And this is what we do sometimes as followers of Jesus when we know him, is we disqualify ourselves immediately. Well, I don't know enough, and I don't pray enough, and I don't know enough of God's word, and I don't feel holy, and I still have an issue with X, and I still have an issue with Y, and I still have an issue with Z. Jesus doesn't care about your qualifications. He cares about your obedience. And if you're a Levi in the audience, you're a Levi online today, you're newer to your faith, Jesus cares about you, but he cares about your friends, and it's time to invite your friends to the table with Jesus. How? Commonway Church is a place where people can come and investigate faith. Ask the hard questions. I would encourage you to be a conduit, to invite them to the table at Commonway. Attend a service, no strings attached. Participate with us when we serve in the community. Attend a life group. Hang out with other followers of Jesus. That is our responsibility, Levi's, to invite our friends to the table. And last but not least, I'm hoping this is where we all eventually lean into. Maybe you're trying to live like Jesus. If you've got some faith under your belt, you've been a follower of Jesus Christ for a while, I'll probably come at you a little hard on this because God calls us to more than just taking up space. If you want to be like Jesus, you got to live like Jesus. And that means practicing relational proximity. And I've said it a million times again today, but you've got to show up for people in this community. When you're at Ball State, do people know that you're a follower of Jesus? Not in a weird way. There's plenty of weirdos that do stuff in weird ways for Christians. I'm saying, when you show up, can people tell that there is grace and hope and mercy and love? Not that you've got it all figured out, but when you show up on campus, in your corporate job, again, in your mom group, in your neighborhood, can they tell that you're a follower of Jesus? That's relational proximity. And then if you've got that going on, are you practicing relational intimacy? Here's my question for you that want to be like Jesus. Are you willing to make room at your table? I'm going to be really specific. At your table for others. Because as followers of Jesus, it's not just about showing up. It's about inviting people into our lives and connecting them closer to Jesus. So let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this place today. I thank you for your word. It's rich, it's powerful, it's alive. I thank you for the idea of what Jesus did of gathering around the table. There is power in this. And I pray that over the next few weeks, you'll open up our minds, our hearts, that we will not simply be people that go to church and check boxes, but that we will gather around the table and make a difference. Father, today I pray for those that would call themselves far from you, sinners. God, would you give them the courage today to take a step, to sit at your table, to walk in relationship, to admit their sins, to believe in you, to choose your leadership. And I pray that before they leave this place today, Lord, that they will speak that to someone. Father, I pray for the Levites in our audience, online and in this place today, the new followers of Jesus. God, I pray that you give them courage to not disqualify themselves from making a difference. That they don't have to have it all figured out. They just need to obey you. And so God, I pray that they act like Levi and gather people regularly to hang out with other Jesus followers, to begin this relationship. Father, I pray for Commonway Church, probably for a lot of us in this place that call themselves Jesus followers. And Holy Spirit, would you challenge us to the core? To show up in the lives of others, to practice relational proximity, so when people see us, interact with us, they see Jesus. God, would you challenge followers of Jesus in here not to only do relational proximity, but relational intimacy, that there are times in our life where we make space at our table, make space in our finances, make space on our calendar, make space in our homes for people to come in, where we lower our walls and connect with them more deeply and connect them with Jesus. Father, I thank you. It is an honor to be here today. I am grateful for the hard work of so many pastors and staff. I'm grateful for the work and heavy lifting of the elder team. I'm grateful for the search team and what they've done over these months, God, and how this church has been established over years. And Lord, we celebrate what you've done. We thank you for what you've done. We are grateful for what you are doing. And God, we ask you to bring on the next chapter. God, whatever you have, we are excited. We want more of you. So lead us by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray this in your name. And if you agree with me, say that last word. Amen. Amen. It's an honor and a privilege to be with you. Blah, 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 blah. It's an honor and a privilege to be with you here today. We'll continue this series next week with week two of being around the table. Have a great day. I know we've got some things out in the foyer for you guys. Have a great week.